Praise God. Just for anybody that's been not been here over the last weeks, we have come to the last part of a six-volume series. This is the last sixth volume I'll be teaching tonight. We've been doing a series called The Law, Lawlessness, and the Spirit of Liberty. Law, Lawlessness, and the Spirit of Liberty. And we've been going through the book of Romans over the last five series. We've been looking at why God has liberated us from the law of Moses and brought us into a new law, the law of the Spirit. Why he has liberated us from lawlessness, living an ungodly life, a lawless life, a controlless life, and brought us to a life controlled by the Holy Spirit. Amen. So we've been looking at, the last week we saw the law of liberty. We looked at how we are not living, in fact, in under the Mosaic law, but we are living under the law of liberty. We looked at that, and we looked at different laws that are there in the Bible. In fact, we saw that it is not the law of Moses anymore, but it is the New Testament laws. And just to get a quick recap on what these laws we looked at, in fact, after studying the scriptures last week, I found one more law of the New Testament, and I'll just add that in for those of you who missed last week. We saw last week in Romans 8 and verse 2 that there is a law of the Spirit. Amen. Everybody say law of the Spirit. Then we saw in Romans chapter 3 and verse 27, there is a law of faith. There's a law of faith. Then we saw there is in James in chapter 2 verse 12 and James chapter 1 verse 25, we saw there's a law called the law of liberty. There's a law of liberty. And this law, according to the New Testament, is called the perfect law. Or, imagine the scripture calling something the perfect law. And he's saying it is not the Old Testament laws and all of that that is brought to that perfection. It is the New Testament, the perfect law, in James 1:25 and James 2:12. Then we looked at Galatians 2 and verse 6, sorry, Galatians chapter 6, and we looked at verse 2, there is a law of Christ. Then we looked at Galatians 6:16, there is a law of the new creation. Then we looked at James chapter 2 and verse 8, we saw the royal law, which is the law of the love of God, the royal law. And one more law to add to the New Testament, just in case you thought New Testament doesn't have laws. You see, the Bible says, 2 Peter 2:12, the Bible says that there is a law called the holy law. Hallelujah. Everyone say holy law. Now this word holy in the Hebrew, we have seen the word holy is the word kadosh. And the word kadosh means to be set above. Everyone say set above. So the moment you're saying this is a holy law, that the new covenant law is a holy law, the moment you say that, you're basically saying that this law of God is set above the other laws. These laws are set above the other laws. They're not below those laws. They're set above the other laws, which means it is the perfect law that God has finally brought the church back into. And what is this perfect law? This perfect law is the law from where Adam and Eve had fallen. He had fallen from the life in the Holy Spirit, born as the sons of God, walking with God out of intimacy. And they had fallen from that and walked away from that perfect law. And after that, they were from falling from that law of God, the law of the Holy Spirit, they lived a life without a law. And that was the season of the conscience, where everything their conscience said, right or wrong, they followed. After that, you see a season comes where Moses comes. There's the Mosaic law. And through the law, the Judaic people, they followed those law, because by following those 10 commandments, they would become righteous. And along with it, the Pharisees added another 603 laws, 613 laws altogether, made them righteous. But Paul was saying, concerning the law, I was blameless, Paul says. But later on, he tells in the book of Timothy, he says, I was a chief of sinners. How can you be blameless concerning the law of Moses and yet say, I was the chief of sinners? Why? Because he did not break the Ten Commandments, but deep in his heart, he knew he needed a savior. Hallelujah. That the old covenant laws just covered sin. But the New Testament laws, they not only covered sin, but what did they do? He washed away all our sins. Hallelujah. Everybody say, washed our sins. Now, how does the Bible say that the New Testament laws have come to place? Are there laws in the New Testament? Indeed, they are. How did the old covenant law come? The old covenant law came because it was given through Moses. Everyone say Moses. Now, the new covenant law was not given through Moses. The Bible declares it was given to us by the apostles and the prophets. Just like the old covenant law was given by Moses, the new covenant law was given by the apostles and the prophets. But in our heart, however, we are not very convinced that the old covenant laws are less, lesser in some sense than the new covenant laws, because when we see the old covenant laws, how they came, Moses went up the mountain and there was fire and there was cloud and there was smoke and there was rumbling and there was, grumbling and, everything was going on over there. And you see that the finger of God comes down and the finger of God writes the Ten Commandments. You got this whole drama that is happening. And so in your mind, you think oftentimes, my goodness, Moses' law has got to be it. But the truth of the scripture is, when you study the scripture, just like when Moses went on top of Mount Sinai to receive the commandments of God, in the same way on the day of Pentecost, when there was a fire on top of the mountain on Sinai, there was a fire on Pentecost. There was a mighty rushing wind. There was in Sinai a rumbling and a thunder. There was a mighty rushing wind on Pentecost. There was the commandments of God that was given in the tablets of stone on Mount Sinai, but there was the commandments of God written by the Holy Ghost inside their hearts. Hallelujah. In the new covenant. Amen. It was 3,000 people that were judged and were killed because they crossed the boundary. The law had said, you shall not cross and touch. Moses told, don't come on this mountain, you will die. And those people sinned and they rebelled. And the Levites, they took out their swords and went. And 3,000 people were killed on Mount Sinai. 3,000 people were filled in the Holy Ghost on Pentecost day. Something had changed on the day of Pentecost, because it was not the old law anymore. It was the law of the Spirit. Amen. Say it loud. The law of the Spirit. Many people think, oh, Moses was a mighty man of God because you got the drama going on. I want you to know that that Holy Ghost which was inside Moses, God has taken that Holy Spirit. Now he has put it upon all flesh. Hallelujah. That every one of you and me, that we can be called not a servant of God like Moses, we can be called nothing less than the sons of the living God. Hallelujah. What a joy to be in the family of God. I am so excited. There are so many times, even this morning, I was just looking at my scriptures and reading, and Hannah was sitting next to me. I mean, I was so excited about this, And I was saying, wow, just wow. And I looked at her and I said, this is good stuff, man. I was just so excited about God's word, the truth of God's word that can just set you free because of the joy of God that comes inside of your life. So we see in the new covenant that the law of God was given through the apostles and the prophets. The New Testament laws are given through apostles and prophets. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 4 and 5. Ephesians 3, 4 and 5. When you read this, you can perceive my insight into the mystery of God. Apostle Paul is writing. You can perceive my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to the sons of men in other generations, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. What is Paul saying? He's saying, in this new covenant time, just like the Ten Commandments were given to Moses on top of the mountain, God has now revealed this New Testament laws through his apostles and prophets, and God has revealed it in these times, and he's written it down in the Bible. Wow, it's exciting. The difference is that the Old Testament people, they would write the Mosaic law was written by one man. But when you look at the New Testament scriptures, they're written by different authors, 27 different books written by different authors at different times. But what a harmony in the commandment. Why? Because it is revealed by the same Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. One Holy Ghost. So you have the apostolic leadership revealing the commandments of God through the scriptures, where Paul reveals that it is by faith in Christ that the righteous requirement of the law has now been fulfilled in everyone that believes. So we looked last time at, we looked at this in the last five series, we looked at all the chapters of Romans except Romans 8 and Romans 16. Now, Romans 16, I won't be looking at that, but you go home and read it. It's such a wonderful book. It's greeting all the wonderful people of God. If you look at Romans 16, there's something you will see in that. He goes on to greet Aquila, Priscilla. He goes on to greet Mary. He goes on to greet Tryphona and Tryphesia. He greets, you know, Andronicus and Junius and so many of these people. But you look at that, he greets them and says statements about different people. He says, greet Andronicus and Junius, who are outstanding among the apostles. Oh, greet Tryphona and Tryphesia. Yeah? Tryphena and Tryphosa. Greet them. And he says, because they have worked hard among you. Greet Mary, who has worked hard among you. Beloved in the brethren. Epaphroditus, your beloved brethren. In Philippians, he writes, sends you his greeting. Beloved brethren and your messenger to you. When you look at many of these portions, not one place does Paul address, greet the man of God who's mighty in signs, miracles, and wonders. Not once. But he goes on to address these people who have worked hard and have been faithful in the Lord's ministry. You know what that means? The Bible did not record in the greetings. When Paul thought about whom does he give thanks to at the end of Romans, he could have thought of all the mighty miracle workers, signs, wonders, all the prophets of the time. But he didn't do that. He simply said, who all are faithful in the house of God? Please tell them my greetings to them. Please tell them thank you. Please tell them that heaven is recording. Can you imagine? Can you imagine when these guys were faithful, serving in Rome? Did you imagine that God of heaven would write the name down in scripture? And some of us, you know, will be excited to see their name in scripture. But I want you to know, some of you, your names are right now being written in glory because of your faithfulness. Heaven has not forgotten your labor of love. Heaven has not forgotten the things you have done for him, in secret or in public, where others have seen, others have not. God takes pains to record it. Hallelujah. Amen. So we looked at that. Now I want to come today to the book of Romans in chapter 8. This is the last chapter in the book of Romans that we're going to deal with. And we're looking at Romans in chapter 8, and the Bible talks about, it talks about, you're not going to live a life because of laws, do's and don'ts. You're not going to live a life saying the grace of God has forgiven me all my sins, so I can live however I want. I can do what I want. But the Bible is saying now in Romans in chapter 8, he's saying now there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. So many people need to understand this is a new law. What is this new law? For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set me free from the law of sin and death. So God is saying that law of sin and death, which was the law of sin and death? The law of sin and death was the law which was working in my body, in the members of my body, because my body wants to sin, but my spirit wants to obey God. And there's a law of the mind, there's a law of the body, and there's a law of the spirit. And the law of the spirit is now setting me free from the law of sin and death, which is in my body, which was ruling my body all these. And he goes on to explain in Romans 8 how this is possible. How is it possible for somebody to live a life of victory? How is it possible for somebody to walk in such a life of victory that sin shall not have any dominion over you? Is it possible? And the Bible declares that it is possible. Now, but it goes on in Romans chapter 8. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus for the law of the Spirit of life. Everyone say law of the Spirit of life. Now, life is in the law of the Spirit. How does a New Testament Christian find life? There is an eternal life which is available only by the Holy Ghost. In the Mosaic law, the law outside would, because I would read the law outside, do not murder, do not sin, do not commit adultery, do not covet. I read the laws outside, and the inside I'm trying very hard to change because of those laws outside. But what happened when the Spirit of liberty came on my life? God put his Holy Spirit inside your life and my life, that now because of the Spirit of God inside, there is a conviction that I love God and I want to follow. And so those laws are inside, not outside. Those laws are not written on tablets of stone that they kept inside the tabernacle and they would keep and look from afar. And every time they would see that, they would think, oh, the law is in that box. And they saw the cloud and they saw the fire. Now it's no longer like that. See, it intimidates you when you see the cloud and fire outside. It intimidates you when you see the glory of God coming down, and you know that you're afraid of that. You're not sure that whether you're at peace with God, what God has done, because you are not at peace with God. This is the perfection of God. The best of your righteousness is here.
The glorious people, many of them sin, their righteousness here. Maybe the great saints or the leaders, their righteousness here. So, and the worst sinner, your righteousness is here. And the Bible declares, it doesn't matter where your righteousness is, neither you nor me, we've been able to come to the perfection of God. Amen. So what did Christ do? Knowing that with the best of our righteousness, we're not able to come there, Christ paid the penalty and took all of us and put us in the right hand, seated on the right hand with the Father. Hallelujah. Seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Amen. Look at somebody and say, you are the righteousness of God in Christ. Come on. Amen. Do you know that? Do you know that God has made you righteous? Do you know that God has made you righteous not because you sinned or you didn't sin? God made you righteous because Christ paid the penalty for your sin and my sin. Hallelujah. And it has nothing to do with what you feel. It has nothing to do with how you got up this morning, whether you read your Bible this morning or any of that. It is the total mercy of God. What is mercy? Mercy is He paying the penalty for your sin. And what is grace? Grace is the empowerment of God. What you could not reach is perfection, God did for you, and He's taken you up. Hallelujah. Now that we are the righteousness of God, God is saying, I'm not going to change you by writing laws outside. I'm going to change you by that Holy Ghost that you saw as a cloud and fire outside. I'm going to take that Holy Spirit. I'm going to put it inside of you. Amen. Now, just imagine, David had a revelation about this. David was saying, where can I go from your presence, O God? Now, if the Holy Ghost was outside on a mountain, or if it was in Jerusalem, or if it was in the tabernacle, you could look at it from afar and you could run away. Now, what God has done, He's taken that Holy Ghost and put it inside of you. Now, where can you run away from that? Hallelujah. If you got to run away, He's inside of you. If I go to the highest mountain, you are there. If I go to the deepest ocean, He's there. If you go and hide in, anywhere, He's there. The Holy Ghost is in you. Hallelujah. And what the Bible is saying is that the Bible calls the Holy Spirit the finger of God. What does He call Him? Now, if you notice, Moses, his Ten Commandments on top of the mountain on a stone was written by the finger of God. And Jesus looks at the Pharisees and says, if I by the finger of God cast out demons, what is that? The Holy Spirit. If I by the Holy Ghost cast out demons, or the finger of God cast out demons, you know what? Moses saw the finger of God write those Ten Commandments on those tablets of stone. Now what Bible is saying, a new thing I'm going to do. I'm not going to write those laws on stone. I'm going to write them on your heart of flesh. Hallelujah. The finger of God inside of you. Come on, look at somebody and say, the finger of God is inside of you. Amen. What is He doing there? He is writing the laws of God on your heart. He's writing in your heart. Now, maybe your flesh is not in agreement with that law. Maybe your mind is saying, I love this law, but my flesh is not in agreement. And how do I be liberated from sin? How can I walk away from sin? And the Bible declares, when He begins to write these laws in your heart, if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the flesh. Why has He given you the Holy Ghost? Many people say, oh, He's given us the Holy Ghost to live a holy life. Now, because I'm holy, they think, oh, I can't hear from God. I wish I could hear the voice of God. I never get to hear the voice of God. And you ask them why. Oh, I'm not such a holy person. That's why I don't get to hear the voice. It's far from the truth. The truth is, because you're not a holy person, God has given you the Holy Ghost, so you need the voice of God. Amen. If any of you say, you don't know, I'm not a holy person, you are the right candidate for the Holy Ghost. Amen. You need Him more than anybody else. Hallelujah. Look at somebody and say, you need the Holy Ghost. Come on. That's true. You need the Holy Ghost. Because if you're not holy, if you're not smart enough, you're not wise enough, it is for you God has given the Holy Ghost. Why? So that with the Holy Spirit inside of me, I have now the power of God inside of me to begin to fulfill the requirements of the law. The self-righteous guys, they don't need the Holy Ghost. I mean, they don't know they need the Holy Ghost. Even if the Holy Ghost came, they wouldn't let Him do anything. But it is the people that are saying that, Lord, I'm a sinner. And you're the ones that are saying, yes, you're the one that needs the anointing of the Holy Ghost. You are the one that needs this life of the Holy Spirit. And it is recorded in Romans in chapter 8. And the Bible says in Romans 8 verse 1, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, for the law of the Spirit of life, Christ Jesus set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do weak as it was in the flesh, God did, sending His Son. Look at verse 4. In order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in them who do not walk according to the flesh but according to the spirit. The righteous requirement of the law, which means the law making you righteous, the only way that you could become righteous now according to righteousness of the law, the only way was now, the Bible is saying, not just by believing in Jesus, the only way you could be righteous was actually living a life in the Holy Ghost, receiving this New Testament life, amen? This New Testament Christian life. I love telling people like this. I said, you are born for a life in the flesh, but you are born again for a life in the Holy Spirit, amen? God did not get you born again to be lost and blind and I don't know, I never hear his voice, I don't know what to do. He's brought liberty into your heart by putting this Holy Spirit inside your heart. Amen. Everyone say, Holy Spirit in me. This Holy Spirit in you is your New Testament beacon of light. There's such a joy. There are so many scriptures in this that just tell you about who you are transformed to be. Now, look at Romans in chapter 8. I'm going to show you some things that the Holy Ghost does. If you live this life of the Holy Ghost, he liberates you to do a lot of things. He liberates you to do a lot of things. What are some of the things he liberates you to do? In Romans 8 and verse 4, the Bible says, he helps you to fulfill the requirement of the law, which means when the Holy Spirit, you begin to fellowship with the Holy Spirit, this Holy Spirit helps you to fulfill what that law requirement, the righteous requirement, by faith, the Holy Spirit inside of you. Now, what many people do not understand is that the Holy Spirit and the human spirit does a lot of things like the body. For example, our human body has eyes. We have. But do you know that the spirit man has eyes? The human body has ears, but the spirit man has spirit ears. That's why you can be looking at somebody and hearing in the spirit man. Hallelujah. The Holy Ghost will be whispering in your ear. Which ear? Not this ear. In the spirit man's ear. Hallelujah. Many of the guidance of the Holy Spirit happens in the spirit man's ear. That's why some people ask, did you hear audible voice? Hey, that's a foolish question. Because if you're speaking to the natural man's ears, he needs an audible voice. If God is speaking to the spirit man's ears, you don't need an audible voice. You need a spirit voice speaking to the Holy, through the Holy Ghost into the spirit man's ears. That's why you can just be standing there and like, wow. Wow, God, whoa. You know, you can be so excited because and the others will be standing there and wondering, what's he so excited about? What's he thinking about? Yeah, well, he ain't thinking about anything. The Holy Ghost is fellowshipping with him. He's talking to him, walking with him. It'll be so exciting. One day I heard the story. I really loved the story. This man of God called Bill Johnson. And he was sharing a story. One day he was just walking by and he heard the Holy Spirit tell him, hey, Bill, someone. He said, Mary Ann bought a new washing machine. So Bill Johnson went, what? So he said, Mary Ann bought a new washing machine. So Bill Johnson said, so? What's the big deal with Mary Ann? And the Holy Ghost told him, it says, oh, I thought we were friends. I thought friends would talk. I mean, see, God is not only talking to tell you world-changing things. Amen. The grace of our, what? What does scripture say? The grace of our traditional Christians, help me. If there's such a name, traditional Christian, carnal Christians, help me. The grace of our and the fellowship of the Holy Ghost. Fellowship is not only world-changing things. Amen. Fellowship is not only official press release by the government of India. Fellowship is when you and your friend go home, sit down, and you say, hey, nice washing machine. Yeah, really? Pretty cool, huh? And I think, see, this is what we're missing out on. We're missing out on this, not the life of the law. Oh, I gotta do, I shouldn't do, I gotta do. Will I make it to heaven? Will I not make it to heaven? Can I do, can I? No, it's not that. We're liberated now into a life of a fellowship with the God of glory. Hallelujah. Fellowshipping with the King of Glory in such a way. We're so excited, but he can tell you small things. Hannah and I, through the years, we have learned how to pray and ask God. There are many things that before, you know, we were afraid to decide. Should we decide this? Can we do that? Should we decide that? We're afraid. But as the years have gone by, the fellowship with the Holy Ghost, when we're unsure of what to do, we tell each other, okay, let's pray and come back. And, you know, we go back and pray about it. And we come back and just to bugger our ass, so what did God say?
You know, and she'll say, "You're the husband. You tell me what God said." So pull each other's leg. Anyway, finally, we tell each other, "This is what I sense the Holy Spirit saying." You know, it is such a beautiful life for every Christian. I said every Christian. Amen. God did not give you the Holy Ghost so that you need to go to prophet or pastor or someone else to hear the voice of God. Jesus said, "My sheep, they hear my voice." Amen. One of the first things that happened in a New Testament church is that God gave you the Holy Ghost as a guarantee of the sonship that you have. Hallelujah. Every time I pray in the Holy Spirit, when I pray in the Holy Ghost, you know, what is it? Before, I would just be thinking, "I'm building my faith, I'm building my faith, I'm building my faith." Because Jude verse 20 says, pray in the building your faith in the most holy faith by praying in the Holy Ghost. Jude 20. So I'd be thinking, I was praying up and down, walking and praying, and I'm building my faith, I'm building my faith. But nowadays, when I pray in the Holy Ghost, what comes to mind is, oh, I'll be praying and I'll say, "Wow, I'm the Son of God." Because He gave the Holy Spirit as a seal of my adoption. Every time you pray in the Holy Ghost, remember you're the Son of God. He did not give that seal of the Holy Ghost to all the Jews. He did not, even in today's time, Jews, today's time and age, the Jews, they don't have the seal of the Holy Ghost inside of them. Some of their prophets and priests and judges and kings may have the Holy Ghost. But this Holy Ghost, which was upon their prophets, kings, judges and priests, is today upon all flesh. Hallelujah. That fire which was on top of that mountain, God took that fire and made it personal. Every one of you, a tongue of fire upon you, the fire of God inside your spirit. Hallelujah. The liberty that has come from following all those laws and living in fear, God is saying, "Now I'm liberating you. You can be filled with the Holy Ghost." Listen, I got good news for you. You have no fear. Amen. You don't have to live in fear of your future. Many people come and ask us, "Aren't you afraid?" I remember years ago when I finished my medicine, came into full time, and you know, there was this $1 million question: how are you going to live? People come and ask me, "How are you going to live? How are you going to live?" I almost want to tell them, "I live by eating food." They mean to ask, "Where are you going to get your money from?" So, you know, because they'd ask, you know, "How are you going to live?" I simply told them, "The exact way you're going to live, I'm going to live." So they will say, "We are working and living." So I said, "Oh, so you don't depend on God?" No, we depend on God only. God only supplies. I said, "Same God supplies me also." So the whole issue of how do I live, you know, how do we live, how's God? And we see that God is faithful. Amen. But if we can listen to the voice of the Holy Ghost. I remember she wanted to do her master's years ago. And so we prayed about it. And she came and said, "I want to do my master's, maybe in Velo." And, you know, I said, "No, maybe that's not a good idea." Because I felt in my heart the Holy Spirit putting a check saying, "No, don't let the family be separated." We just decided, we prayed about it. We decided together that we don't have to do our master's. Because I am not my master's. I am a child of God. Amen. And as a child of God, if the master's is going to help in the ministry, let the Lord open a door in a time and season where after a marriage we don't have to stay apart for 3 years or 4 years. And we took that decision. And she did her master's 10 years later. What did we miss? Nothing. What did we gain? A fantastic life in the Holy Ghost. Amen. Really. See, there is freedom in this life in the Holy Spirit. There's freedom in hearing God's voice. There's freedom in knowing the will of God in our time and generation. In a child of God's life, there are no accidents. Amen. I'm telling you. In a child of God's life, there are no accidents. There are some incidents, I agree. But when you just baptize that incident in the anointing of the Holy Ghost, God makes that, turns that into a plan for your destiny. Hallelujah. Where God just steps into that situation. So the Bible says here, the Holy Spirit helps me fulfill the requirement of the law. Number two, the Holy Spirit brings peace and life. Verse 6, it says, "For the life, the mind set on the flesh is death, but the mind of the Spirit is life and peace." Number three, the Holy Ghost helps me please God. Verse 8, "I'm not able to please God by myself, but the Holy Spirit, He helps me to please God." Verse 9, "The Holy Spirit tells me that I belong to God." Amen. Every time I'm somewhere, you know, those of you that have been married and during your marriage, you know, you put a ring on. You know, this ring that you put on, many of you probably don't know why you put it. Don't tell me the white man put it, so you put it. You know, some of you never put the ring on. I was joking this morning. I was saying, some of you, you know, your husband didn't marry you. The Achan married you. You know, he put that ring on for you, and he put the whatever the different things that he did, that the priest married you. And thankfully, he didn't sign at bridegroom on the signature, you know, in that. Because why? Why am I saying that? Because in a Christian marriage, it is not your signing of the register. It is not your ring, or it is not any of this that gets you married. It is the covenant. It is the word that you speak out of your mouth. The vow that you give your wife. That is the sign of the covenant. Amen. So, when we get married, we put most of you, you're wondering why you put the ring on. All right. Why do you put the ring on? Sorry, sign of love. No, it's a sign of the covenant you make with your spouse. Every time, just like the rainbow was a sign of the covenant in the sky, in the same way, when you look at your ring on your finger, you know that there is a sign of the covenant that God has put on your heart, on your heart. Hallelujah. Now, you know, so that you go come to a place, or it can be whatever the sign is. It doesn't have to be a ring. Amen. See, some people think, I'm married because of the ring. You're not married because of the ring. Hello? The ring is just showing, declaring, hey, hello, I got married. Amen. You're not married because of the ring. You're married because of the word. The covenant that you made before God and before man. And what is the Bible saying? That just like this is a, just like, you know, the ring is a sign of your covenant. In the same way, there is the Holy Ghost inside of you, which is the sign of your sonship. Amen. Did you put that Holy Ghost on? You didn't put the Holy Ghost on. He gave you that Holy Ghost, as the Bible declares it, as a guarantee. Everyone say guarantee. You know, it's like he's made a down payment. That's the word for the Holy Ghost guarantee. He's given you the Holy Ghost as a down payment, telling you about what is to come. Wow. Hallelujah. So every time you got the Holy Ghost inside of you, you're not thinking, oh, I don't know about the law. I don't know about this. I don't know about that. Every time you got the Holy Ghost inside of you, when you're sensing, you're saying, hey, that's the guarantee of the things to come. Amen. You're saying that, wow, God is guaranteeing me that I'm going to heaven. He's guaranteeing me that I'm celebrating the goodness of God. Everyone shout guarantee. Guarantee. See, he's the guarantee of the book. He's the guarantee of inheritance, that you are not an orphan. You're not a childless person. He is the guarantee that you're the son of God. Wow. Hallelujah. He did not leave you without a father. He did not leave. Some people say, I wish my father was there. Then I'd had a great future. You got it wrong. A lot of people have their fathers and still have a messed up future. Your father is your heavenly father. What changes your future? It is not your father's presence or not father's presence. What changes your future is the intimate fellowship with the Holy Ghost. Grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. Love of the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Ghost, where you can intimately hear from God. He can guide you. He can walk with you. He can talk with you. That is why the Bible begins to talk so much about being led by the Holy Ghost. So he gives life. The Holy Ghost then, he helps you, verse 13, he helps you put to death the deeds of the flesh. There's a liberty. You're not struggling with the flesh so much anymore. Where by the Spirit, you're learning to say no to the flesh. But some people say, oh, I have the Holy Ghost, I prayed, but nothing changed. Now, what changes is this? I shared a story this morning. I was saying, you know, one day there was a man who had two dogs, all right? One black dog and one white dog. All right, they take this black dog and white dog, that took him, he would take this dogs to the church, because this small village, the whole community would come to church. And at the church, you know, after the church, they'd have this dog fight. And people would bet on these dogs. So one week, he would say the black one would win. And the others would bet, no, the white one would win. And that week, the black one would win. So, and others would think, okay, so black one is stronger than white. Next week, he will come and say, white one will win. Everybody will say, no, black one won. Because last week, they remembered. And that week, the white one would win. And so, the week after, they'll say, wait a minute. This time, the white one won. All right, next week, they'd say, the white will win. He said, no, the black will win. Every time, the dog he said won. So, somebody asked him, wait a minute. How is it that the dog you're saying is winning? So, he said, very simple. One week, I feed the black one and I starve the white. And the next week, I starve the white one and I feed the black. And he said, whichever dog I feed wins. And that is so true in your Christian life. You feed the spirit man, your spirit man will win. Amen. You feed the flesh man, your flesh man will win. Our problem is not that God doesn't love us. Our problem is God is not that he's not committed to us. Our problem is the fellowship with the Holy Spirit.
Amen. That if you knew, many people think, oh, my life is like this because pastor doesn't have time for me, or my cell leader doesn't have time, or my church doesn't pray for me. No, no, no. Your life and my life are missing what it takes because God did not say that you will be intimate with your pastor and have breakthrough. He said the Holy Ghost shall come upon you. Amen. He said you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost comes upon you. The Holy Spirit is the New Testament Christian's guarantee. Amen. Everybody say guarantee.
Yes. I like that. You know, when I fly, I have a frequent flyer on a couple of airlines and all that. When I fly, you know, and I have one airline I usually travel on. And when I go there, you know, there's this frequent flyer card. You pull it out and like to flash it, you know. And you're looking where others are looking, you know.
And the kind of treatment they give you because they got that card. And the number of times I've just gone in economy and I landed up in business. And why? The guarantee. Amen. We came in as economy class servants of God. He's made us sons of God. He's sending us in business. Amen. It's not true. Oh, there's some languages you understand. Amen. All right. I told you all of this in different ways in the last 5 weeks. All right. But suddenly when it came to comfort, luxury, my goodness, you guys like it. All right. So it's business class. Amen. You see, the best of the promises, when you look, the Jacob promises does not come equal to the Abrahamic promises, because all of the Jacob promises were to the land of Israel. They were for earth, but the Abrahamic promises were for eternity. Yeah. Hallelujah. There's something that happens. The Holy Ghost comes on you. Then verse 14, the Holy Ghost leads you. He speaks to you. He teaches you. He leads you. 15, he adopts you into the family. Now, then verse 16, he bears witness, you know, that you're sons of God. Everywhere you go, the Holy Spirit in you, there's a liberty. You're not wondering, am I a child of God or am I not? Am I a servant of God? Am I not? Holy Spirit bears witness, comforts you. He's your comforter. Amen. Amen. He tells you, don't be afraid. I'm there for you. I'll be there for you everywhere you go. A lot of people are worried about their future. One of the things that I have seen that the Holy Ghost does, at least for me, this has been very, very powerful. And it takes a revelation to understand this. One of the things that the Holy Ghost does in your life, he deals severely with fear in your life. The Holy Ghost, the Bible says, for God has not given us a spirit of fear. The Holy Ghost and the fear cannot dwell together. If you got fear in your heart, it's because you have not seen the guarantee. Amen. If you got fear in your heart, some of you have FDs, right? How have you got FDs? Yeah, at least shake your head like this so I'll know you have. You know, some of you have FDs. You're Indian shaking like that, you know, you're not sure which way it's like that. You know, so some of you got FDs. And when you look at your FD, you feel, if something goes wrong, this is there. You look at God's word, it is life. And the Holy Spirit is the guarantee inside your heart. There is no fear. Come on, tell somebody, no fear. Holy Ghost is here. Amen. There is no fear in your heart. Why? Because, you see, you know, a few weeks ago, I was preaching at the Matanam service, and I preached a message called, He is my source. Amen. So many people think that your wealth is your source, your salary is your source, your family is your source, all of that. No, that is not true. He is your source. Amen. When he opens a door, no work of the devil can close it. Hallelujah. When he wants to bless you, no plan of the enemy can stop that. Hallelujah. Why? God has put a guarantee inside of you. Amen. All he's asking is live this life of freedom. Don't worry about the law. Don't live in lawlessness. Live a life of freedom from all these things. Why? Guarantee is inside of you. He will teach you. He will comfort you. If you sin, he is an advocate before the Father. Hallelujah. What a joy to live this life with a guarantee. And then the Bible says he gives heirship. He helps in weakness when you pray. Verse 26 says, I don't know how to pray. How many of you are saying, I don't know how to pray? Come on, just show me your hands. If you don't know how to pray, the Bible says, just pray in the Holy Ghost. Amen. But I don't understand anything. Well, he didn't tell you you'll understand. He said he will help you pray. Amen. He said he'll help you pray. What will you be praying? It may sound like this. Many years ago, a man of God, wonderful man of God, taught us about praying in tongues. Ever since I've been a tongue-talking fanatic. I love praying in the Spirit. And though people who've known me for many years, they've seen me pray in the Spirit all the time. And so this man called Dave Robertson, many years ago, 1996, I think, he taught us the power of praying in tongues. And then he said, when you pray in tongues, when you pray in the Spirit, you're actually praying mysteries, all right? Everyone say mysteries. Now, the thing about mysteries is that Is anything a mystery to God? Then who is it a mystery for? That's what the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 14. When anyone prays in tongue, your mind is unfruitful, but you are praying mysteries to God. So before that, you'll be praying in known languages. Lord, you know my wife. She's really troubling me, Lord. You need to fix her. Lord, she's really bothering me. And then you'll stand there and start praying in tongues. Shakaramayan talabas. Okay. And the tongues would be mysteries to you. And the interpretation here will be, Lord, my wife is not the problem. I am the problem, Lord. Fix me, Lord. Fix me good. You see, this is the thing about prayer. Because the Bible says in Romans 8:26, if you know, when, for we don't know how to pray. Amen. Someone saying, awesome, you're not married. Just wait till you get married. Just wait. The Holy Ghost will be praying some things. Yeah. So he's praying mysteries. Mysteries. It's not mysteries to God. It's mysteries to us. And that is why I encourage every one of you to have fellowship with God. Pray in the Holy Spirit. Why? Because you will be praying mysteries to you, things you don't know about, that the Holy Ghost will be telling the Father. And there is so much power in that prayer. The guarantee is praying according to the rule book. Hallelujah. Where there's so much freedom in praying in the Spirit. And the Spirit of God is praying what? Mysteries. Things you don't understand. Things you haven't seen. Things that you, maybe 30 years from now, things about your children's next future. You're saying, God, I really want to invest this particular money for their future generation. But you begin to pray in tongues and the Holy Ghost is praying on your behalf. And he's saying, God, let this man not worry about his children's future. Let him know according to Philippians 4:19. And my God shall supply all your needs according to your FD, according to your what? According to what? According to your Father's inheritance given to you. What is your guarantee? His riches in glory. Hallelujah. So my guarantee from the Holy Ghost is that my God's riches are available to me. Hallelujah. Not only to me, to my generation and to my generation and to my generations. Many years ago, there was a dear pastor. I had the privilege or the honor of maybe paying for some of his children's education. And, prayed for his oldest child's uni education and paid for the second daughter's uni education. When it was coming to the third child, and I was supporting some amount of third. As a young Christian, I wanted to just do something for pastors. And the money I had, I just give and bless people and do stuff like that. And this pastor one day, while I just blessed him, he looked at me. He was almost in tears and he said like this. He said, Dr. John, every 2 months I'd have to really seek God, for provision for my daughter's school fees. And he was so in tears and he said, Dr. John, do you know for the first time I have enough money to pay 6 months advance for all my children's, for my children's education. Thank you so much, he said. You know what I did? I wasn't married then. I didn't understand the pressure of being a father having to pay the children's education. I don't know what that means. So I looked at him and I just said a word of faith. I looked at him and I said, Pastor, I just want you to know something. Because you're saying your daughter's 6 months money is taken care of, school fees. I just want you to know, because of this, my children next 60 years taken care of. Amen. Why? Because this is not my source. My God is my source. Come on, tell somebody, God is my source. Come on. And the Holy Ghost is my guarantee. Amen. See, the thing is, that's the truth. It breaks fear. One of the things the Holy Ghost wants to do, he wants to break that intimidation of fear. So every time you're afraid, there is a liberty from fear. When you fellowship with the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. You're afraid. Who will feed me? Who will take care? What about my bills? Get inside that room. Lock the door. Talk to the one who is the source. Amen. Let you pray. You 1 hour of praying in the Holy Ghost. There is a liberty that happens to your life. He is liberating you from fear. Come on, tell somebody, don't fear, the Holy Ghost is here. Come on. That's true. If you only understood the power of walking under the Holy Ghost, where the spirit eyes you can see, spirit ears you can. Many times I go to some cities, when I land up there itself, the people in the churches will come and they talk to the main speaker, because they want the main speaker to preach on their behalf. To the crowd, So they'll come and say, Pastor, what the problem is? One uncle is here, come straight from Pathanamthitta and now living in Nagpur. Great big trouble in our churches. So they'll be talking about this uncle and that person, this one. And after, being there and they're hearing all, and half the time I don't listen to half these things they say. Because they'll be talking about, you know, the problem here is that, the problem here. They want to doubt you with their doubt, fear and unbelief. In a new place, I go, a lot of people say, Pastor, you don't know the problem here. Thank you, I don't know the problem here. Thank you so much. We have enough problems of our own back in our own. You know, thank you. I don't want to know what your problem is. I've come to tell you what the solution is. Amen. They say the problem is this, the problem is that. Everywhere you go, simple preaching. The answer is the Holy Ghost. I can't tell you how much. God has not called you to be visitors in church. He's called you to be sons and daughters with the guarantee of the Holy Ghost inside of you, that He can anoint you and send you out with the word of truth. Hallelujah. There is such a freedom under this anointing of the Holy Spirit. It gives you heirship, helps you in weakness in prayer, reveals the will of God. It does so much for your life. Now, when this Holy Spirit comes into your life, He does certain things that Romans in chapter 8, the last part, He says, He fills you so much, but one of the greatest things for you is that He fills you with His love. And Romans 8, the last part says, if God be for us, who can be against us? Amen. How do I know God is for me? Somebody, can you help me, tell me, how do I know God is for me? Some of you say, God is for me if He answers prayer. I think that is a whole bunch of rubbish. No, God is for me because He answered my prayer. Lie. God is for you because He's living with you. He moved in. He changed residence to come inside of you. He's just checked in with you. He's just occupied one of your best favorite bedrooms. Amen. And He's saying, where can I go from your presence? If I go to the highest mountain, He's there. You go to the deepest ocean, He's there. You go to darkest darkness. And the Bible says even darkness is not dark to Him. He's like, hi, yo. Sup? Guarantee is here. How do I know God loves me? He checked in. Amen. Amen. Now that He checked in, listen to me. Whether He answers prayer or does not answer prayer, I have a guarantee that we're going to be celebrating party in heaven. Amen. Amen. That is why Paul, he writes in Romans 8, this light and momentary suffering. What was his light and momentary suffering? They chopped his head. And he called that light and momentary suffering. Someone joked like this, it seems. History records, when they chopped his head bounced 3 times, it means. Just for you Malayalis that come from your traditional background, it seems one pastor said like this, Chattapra moon hallelujah parangandavaya, pray. Which means his head bounced 3 times and hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Minus the jokes. He's the guarantee. Come on, look at somebody and say, guarantee. See, this life of liberty gives you freedom. Amen. He gives you freedom to enjoy the life of God. Led by the Spirit, filled by the Spirit, listening to the Holy Ghost, speaking in the Spirit, seeing in the Spirit. Where they come and they tell you all kinds of things. You know, it's such, I can't explain to you what a fact it is. I go to many places, they constantly tell me, Dr. John, you know the problem of this place? You know why this place won't change? You know the problem of this church? You know why this church won't change? I said, see, if you know the problem, I'm sure you know the solution. So I don't listen too much to these problems because the problems are the same everywhere. Some stuck up pastor, some rebellious church folk, somebody's wife who's giving trouble, some children that are running up the wall. You know, it's the same problem everywhere. And some demon, some stronghold. They'll call this stronghold or that demon, that stronghold. They call it some name, different names at different places. But the solution is the same. If I, by the Spirit of God, 1 John 4:4 says, greater is He that is in me. Who is in you? The guarantee, the Holy Ghost. So how do I have a life of liberty? If I don't have liberty, the reason is because I don't have fellowship with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is my comforter. The Holy Spirit is my peace. Peace. Everyone say peace. Jesus said, my peace I give to you. You look at most of the Christian church, it looks like they didn't get that peace. They missed that peace of Jesus. Oh, I don't know what's going to happen to me. I don't know my future. Your future is in His hand. Amen. Oh, but I don't have money. Nice. Maximum you'll die. That's about it. Once you die, everything's going to be all right. Amen. One of my cousins came to me. I was really mean to him. This was many years ago. Cousin came to me and looked at me and said, "You're going to North India as missionary?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "They'll kill you there, man."
That ticked me off. You know what I did? I put my hand over his shoulder. And I said, "I just want you to know," he was little on the chubby side. I put my hand on his shoulder and said, "I just want you to know, you'll die out of a heart attack before they kill me in North India." He told me they're going to kill me. I told him something's going to kill him. I mean, fair enough. Anyway, thankfully, he's alive, I'm alive. And we are living abundant life. Not because I'm smarter or better, because the Holy Ghost. Because we are partnering with the Holy Spirit. We are living, we are walking, we are talking with Him. So finally, as I close, what does this Holy Spirit give us liberty to do? He gives us liberty to live a full life. That we're not living the suke life, which is the psyche life. We're not living the bios life, which is the body life alone. Eat, drink, die. We're living the Zoe life, which is heaven's life inside of us. Amen. He gives us liberty to move from physical and emotional life alone to move into a spirit-filled life. And there are, I know there are setbacks in life. I know there are deep moments of pain. I know there are losses. And I know so many of you all here, you faced so many losses and so many hard hits you have faced. But I want you to know, I don't care what the hit you've taken, the guarantee is inside. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The guarantee of the Holy Spirit is inside of you. And it says over here, you're liberated to live a full life, an abundant life. You're liberated to live a freedom from sin. You're liberated to worship God. John 4 said, days are coming, you're going to worship neither on this mountain, nor on in Gerishim, you're going to, or in Jerusalem, you're going to worship in Spirit. He's liberating you to worship Him. Not only is He liberating you to worship Him, He's liberating you to give unto Him. When you talk about giving unto Him, you know, many people, they come and ask you, "Pastor, how much should we give, Pastor? Should we give tithe?" Now, Old Testament, so if you're liberated from the law, how much do you give really? You know, if you see, actually what you're liberated from is not from the giving the tithe. All right? You ready for this? In the Old Testament, you had to give tithe. New Testament, you're liberated. From what? Not from giving tithe. You're liberated from the love of money. Hallelujah. You're liberated from the love of money because you're not afraid anymore. Someone asks, how much do we give? Old Testament, 10%. New Testament, how much do we give? One day, a man of God shared something to me. It really shook me up. It has changed my thinking. I know this might be too much for you guys. If you can't handle it, please take it back. Talk to the Holy Ghost about it. Okay? You agree you'll do that? Yeah. Don't judge me. Just take it back and talk to the Holy Ghost. One man of God told me, he said, "John, many people nowadays are asking, how much should I give? How much should I give? How much should I give to the Lord's work?" He said, "The truth is, you shouldn't be asking, how much should I give? The only question you can ask is, Lord, how much should I keep?" Because I am His. Amen. I am His. Now, I'm not saying the Holy Ghost wants you to go hungry on the street. I'm simply saying He, being a Father, He cares for you more than. But in the New Testament, you're liberated from the love of money. Because the Holy Ghost in you tells you that He shall supply all your needs according to riches and glory. Amen. I mean, some of you guys, you've come on the ministry with us. Hasn't God taken care of you? It's amazing. I mean, it's not the church that provided. It's God who provided. Isn't it true that God provided more than the church provided? Isn't it true? It just is. That's just the way God is. Because He is our source. Come on, tell somebody, He's my source. So how do we give? When you give unto God, you're liberated from the clutch of money. Why am I talking about money? Because Matthew 6:24 says, you cannot serve two masters. You cannot serve, you know, both God and mammon. Hallelujah. You can't do that. You can't do that. So the huge challenge for today's churches are money, the love of money. How much do I give? How much do I not give? See, for those of you, they say tithe is an eternal principle. They say, truly, tithing is not an eternal principle. Why? Tithing has been taught in the scripture. The first example you see is that Abraham tithe. Some people ask, how much does your church tithe? I want you to know there's no example of the church tithing anywhere in the Bible. It is always individuals that tired. Pastors tired, Levites tired, church people tired, everyone tired. The church buildings, the church did not tire. What do the churches do? Philippians says they contributed generously to the needs of the missions. Amen. So according to what the Bible says, when your tithes, and you know, the Old Testament talks about bring your tithes and I will prove. New Testament says, talks not just tithes and offerings. See, because Old Testament, tithes is a sign of your faithfulness. Everyone say faithfulness. Offering is a sign of your love. Because offering is not under compulsion. Anything you do out of compulsion is not out of love. Amen. Oh, I have to give 10%. You calculate 10%. Just write down. And 1% for extra in case. I don't want to fall this side, so I'll fall on that side. See, that's out of compulsion. Amen. Anything out of compulsion is out of fear. And the Bible says anything which is out of fear is not out of faith. So you just give 10% without faith. You know what your reward is? Anything done without faith, what's the reward? There's no reward. But you gave that 10% with faith. What's the faith? That faith that God is my source. Hallelujah. What is the faith? God is my source. When you do that God is your source, He steps in. And He begins to work on that part of your life. And He begins to supply that part. You know, in our home, for years we have practiced. We have prayed about our needs. We prayed. We sought God. God, you know, that need is there. We tell the Lord. There are times I've laid hands, not now, years ago. I've laid hands on my refrigerator and I said, fill it up, Lord, in Jesus' name. We've done that. Many times, a number of times, I've taken my wallet and put my hand on it. God, fill it up in Jesus' name. And I walk away. Now, did it get filled up then? No. The source. I tell people I bank with Trinity bankers. I know some of you bank with HSBC, you bank with this and that. We bank with Trinity bankers. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, you know. And no ATM, nothing. He just sends his agents. Hallelujah. Amen. It's true. He just sends his agents. Wow. See, what you got to understand is that God is your source. So, John, can you show me where how I can bank with Trinity bankers? Yes. How? By faith. Oh, well, how do I get the passbook or an account opened? Give and it shall be given to you. Oh, I don't want to bank with that. Good for you. See, He deals with your fear. Everyone say fear. He deals with your giving. He deals with your sin. He deals with you. Liberated from sin. You don't have to live under sin anymore. You don't have to live under sickness. Some people say, oh, why am I still sick? You said, you know, God can heal you. I know there are a lot of Christians sick. I do understand sickness comes to bring us down. But I want you to know there's a difference between healing and wholeness. Healing is a supernatural intervention of God to heal. Hannah was just telling me this morning about an evangelist called Nathan Morris. And it seems in one of his meetings, a young evangelist in the UK, one of his meetings in Dallas recently, a woman 20 years in a wheelchair. She was a pastor's wife. She was paralyzed for 20 years. And for 20 years, she led worship in her church from that wheelchair. Some of you worship leaders need to take a leaf or two from that. From her wheelchair, 20 years she led worship. And she said, I went for so many meetings. Every time I'd go there, people would come and they'd say, you know what, I don't know if I'm being healed. Or they would be, she'd be afraid of people pulling her up and say, walk, walk, walk. And she can't walk. 20 years later, she got healed. Today she's standing and leading worship and singing and praising and all of that. You see, what am I trying to say? 20 years she didn't get healed. That doesn't mean God's not a healer. That doesn't mean that the healing ain't there. 20 years you've not been free. That doesn't mean this is not your day. Today is your day of freedom. And I am not the answer, nor is this church the answer. We are a source of blessing to you. And you are planted in this house to grow. But who is the answer? Fellowship with the Holy Spirit. He is your liberator. He is the one that sets you free. He is the one that sets you into a life of liberty. Liberty to serve God in freedom from the law. Liberty to serve God, not because you have to, but because you love to. Liberty to walk with under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Liberty to give, not because you have to, but because you love. Liberty to forgive, not because you have to, but because you have been forgiven. Liberty to pray for people, not because you have been prayed for, but because the Holy Ghost is interceding within you. You see, there's a liberty, amen. He liberates you to love people. He liberates you to love the ones that hate you. He liberates you to, to forgive the ones that hurt you. He liberates you to bless the ones that cursed you. And I can tell you today, you know, there was somebody who cursed me really badly a few years ago. And I told the Lord, I went back and I said, and you know, it wasn't easy. It was a difficult situation. It was a man of God. I went back and told the Lord, I said, Lord, give me a chance. If ever this man needs me, give me a chance to be there for him. Hallelujah. It liberates you from unforgiveness. It liberates you from all kinds of things. The Holy Ghost in you, it will make you act in the opposite spirit. Amen. And instead of curse, did curse come on me? No. Instead of curse, a blessing came. Why? Because we are being led by the Spirit, filled by the Spirit, walking in the Spirit, talking in the Spirit. It is for freedom that Christ has set you free. So don't go back into the law. Don't go back into lawlessness. But live in life, fellowship with the Holy Ghost. Amen. Every day He will speak to you. He will fill you. He will guide you. He will teach you. And I want you to know He knows your future. He knows your children's future. It's secure in His hands. Amen. He's your source. He will supply all your needs according to His riches in glory. Amen. He's your miracle worker. He's your healer. He's your comforter. He's your ever-present help in time of need. No matter what your need is, He's not something to be feared outside. He's someone to be loved on the inside. Amen. And He's a guarantee of good things to come. Wow, I like that. Guarantee of good things to come in Jesus' name.